Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 2020 James Parks Morton Interfaith Awards in support of the Interfaith Center of New York. My name's Nancy Giles, and I'm so delighted to be your host. As it is 7 p.m. here in New York, I hope you'll join me in a round of applause for the frontline workers who continue their Herculean efforts to keep us safe. Woo! Thank you, frontline workers. You rock. Thank you, everybody. For 23 years, the Interfaith Center of New York, or ICNY, has activated the power of the city's grassroots religious and civic leaders to help New York overcome prejudice, misunderstanding, and violence. Unfortunately, hate and racial injustice hasn't taken a break during the pandemic. One of the things you'll learn tonight is Interfaith Center of New York's rapid response work in a challenging season. I regret to share with you that the center's founder, the Very Reverend James Parks Morton, passed away in January, just days before his 90th birthday. Tonight, we also honor Marian Wright Edelman and Anna Deavere Smith with the award that bears Jim's name, two women who have dedicated their careers to exposing and eradicating injustice. Here to present to them is former Manhattan Borough President Ruth Messinger and the Reverend Dr. Serene Jones, President of Union Theological Seminary. We are also joined by a number of ICNY's staff, board, and honorary board members, as well as partners like Lincoln Center President and CEO Henry Timms, U.S. Census Director Julie Menin, and Manhattan Borough President Gale Brewer, among others, all of whom we thank for their time and support. I'm delighted to introduce our first speaker, Executive Director, Reverend Dr. Chloe Breyer, who's led the organization since 2010. But first, it is my pleasure to share tonight's opening prayer, performed by award-winning Tibetan artist Yuchen Lamo.
May all sentient beings have happiness and its causes. May all sentient beings be free of suffering and its causes.
Thank you to Yuchen Lamo for that beautiful opening prayer. And thank you also to Nancy for being our host this evening. We are so grateful to you. And thanks to all of you for being here tonight, for your presence among us, for your support for the Interfaith Center of New York's work. As Nancy said earlier, unfortunately, the global pandemic has done has really changed little in terms of the need to fight prejudice, hatred, and violence. And those are the main components of our mission, And so the work of the Interfaith Center of New York continues. Indeed, we've seen an uptick in the COVID-related attacks, hate crimes on Asian American New Yorkers. And in addition, of course, the murder of George Floyd has reminded us all how that equal justice under law is still missing in the United States. And it is up to all of us to fight systemic racism. There is an intersection between racism and religion in New York, and we at the Interfaith Center of New York saw that 5 years ago with the police killing of Mohammed Ba, a immigrant from West Africa who was shot by police even as his mother called for help, dialing 911 for mental health assistance for her son. That combination of Mohammed's name, his Muslim identified name, his brown skin color, came together to expose that deep and deadly systemic inequality, which has unfortunately proved so lethal in law enforcement in this country, so lethal for so many, including Sean Bell, Akai Gurley, Amidou Diallo, Deborah Danner, Ramali Graham, Eric Garner, of course, and Breonna Taylor as well. This is why we at the Interfaith Center have spent years forging interfaith alliances across faith traditions and across colors to advocate for police reform and diversity training for law enforcement. This pandemic has challenged all of us. And as far as our institutional response, one thing that we have done since March 18th is to send out a weekly roundup with COVID-related resources for faith communities across New York, and also featured their creative and inspiring responses, be it delivering extra PPE for hospitals or feeding health workers who are working around the clock. We have worked with faith leaders and artists to create the memorial for us all, which you will hear more about this evening. We have brought diverse faith voices to the table when it comes to how we open up our state, not just our city, but how do we open up worship, houses of worship after the threat of COVID has subsided. And finally, we've worked with New York Disaster, Interfaith Disaster Services, and Thrive New York to develop a toolkit and webinar series for faith leaders in their communities on how to combat this deadly kind of mental health threats that have been so aggravated by the isolation and loss prompted by the COVID epidemic. So I can't go much further this evening without saying a thank you to individuals who have really for a long time made this work possible, our major donors. Barbara Slifka, of course, you are one of them. You've been with us for so long and had such faith in us. We are so grateful. Mary Jane Brock and Charlie Brock, you have also been with us for so long. And we thank, of course, Matt Nimitz, who has helped us in so many ways. We're grateful to Trinity Church Wall Street. We are grateful to the Episcopal Diocese of New York and for so many that have made this work possible. And in closing, I just want to add that that we are proud to continue with all our sponsors, our donors, religious leaders who find our work meaningful, to continue with all of you by our side. And I'm now pleased to introduce our first award presenter, ICNY board member and former Manhattan Borough President, Ruth Messinger. Thank you so much.
Hello, I'm Ruth Messinger, and as a board member of the Interfaith Center of New York, and a longtime social justice advocate inside and outside the government, I am delighted to introduce my friend, Marian Wright Edelman, as this year's James Parks Morton Interfaith Awardee. Marian began her pioneering civil rights career as the first Black woman admitted to the Mississippi Bar. She established and directed the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund office in Jackson, Mississippi, in anticipation of Freedom Summer. In 1968, she moved to Washington, D.C. as counsel for the Poor People's Campaign that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. began organizing before his death. A few years later, Marian founded the Children's Defense Fund, an extraordinary organization that has consistently spoken and worked for our next generations. Marian has received many awards and recognitions for her lifetime work for civil and economic rights for African American children and their families, including the Albert Schweitzer Humanitarian Prize, the Heinz Award, and a MacArthur Foundation Prize Fellowship. In 2000, she received the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor. I had the great fortune to learn about Marian when I worked against racism in New York City in the mid-1960s, and to meet her in those various social and political struggles. She is one of those rare people who picks up the shovel and does the work, never seeking recognition, always including others, and being a role model for them. My own career in public service in New York and around the world was influenced by her knowledge and her style, by her passion and her determination. Her work has never seemed so important as in these torturous times. You will now see a short video about Marian Wright Edelman and then hear her words of acceptance.
Have a chance to go and just look at the empty cupboards in the Delta and the number of people who are going around begging just to feed their children. And starvation is a major, major problem now.
I was called to testify in Washington. I asked if they would come and see what was really going on, which was starvation and malnutrition and an attempt to make people leave the state if they were poor and black. And the committee, to my surprise, came. But Robbie Kennedy came with them, and he brought the press for the first time.
I think, of course, Mr. Chairman, that this is a reflection on all of us in the country of 1967 and the most prosperous country in the world, that we would think that all of us would be able to provide for some of our citizens living in this part of the country.
The Children's Defense Fund is the grandchild of the Poor People's Campaign that Dr. Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy started before they were assassinated, and I was blessed to be the policy director for that Poor People's Campaign to continue the work and the dream and the vision of Dr. King to end poverty in America.
I first heard of Marian back in 1960 when she was a student in Atlanta, and people would say, "Ask Marian. Get in touch with Marian." She emerged as a leader, brave, courageous, just smart, real smart. She wanted to do something not just about civil rights, but about children, all children.
The first law that we were able to lead and get enacted in the Congress was the Educational Handicapped Children's Act. We've got millions and millions of children who have health care, and CDF has played a very key role in that. We've got early education investments and Head Start investments that have grown over the years. We've got after school investments that have grown over the years. We've been able to make some cracks in decreasing child poverty, but one of the things we never do is we never give up. And I'm always reminding myself of Dr. King when he said that you must keep moving forward, that if you can't fly, you gotta drive, you can't drive, you gotta run, if you can't run, you gotta walk, and if you can't walk, you gotta crawl. We are not going to go backwards, we're going to go forward and finish the job of the civil rights movement.
I don't know what a country would be like without the Children Defense Fund. If Martin Luther King Jr. could come back and see what Marian Wright Edelman is doing, he would be very proud.
And so I think this is another one of those defining times that offers all of us the opportunity to stand up, fight back, and to form that next movement to end poverty, to create jobs, to make sure that every child is educated.
Children need the sense of hope, the sense of, yes, I too can make a contribution. Yes, I am somebody, and I'm going to do my best.
This is the time for all of us to put aside all of our organizational stuff, to put aside all of our political stuff, and to figure out how we're going to come together to pass on a better country for our children than we inherited.
I'm so honored to receive the James Park Morton Interfaith Center Award, and I'm so grateful for your tireless efforts to combat the economic poverty, racism, violence, hopelessness, that is afflicting the lives of millions of children and people across our nation and globe. We're struggling to realize the lives God, by whatever name we use, intends. Although our nation has made much progress over the last 50 years towards ending poverty, so much remains to be done to ensure every child a healthy, fair, safe, and moral start in life, and successful transition to adulthood and a level playing field as adults to earn enough to live on and share with those left behind. I never dreamed it would be so hard to achieve these goals in our powerful, wealthy United States of America, whose money currency says, "In God we trust." It's past time to define and follow which God we truly mean, whether it's the God of money or the God of all of our children and of all of our professed faith. The prophet Micah told us what the Lord requires of us, which is to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with God. Let's join together as people of all faiths in loving and protecting and building a world to truly leave no child behind anywhere.
Hi, I'm Henry Timms. I'm the president of Lincoln Center. And tonight, I pay tribute to the work of the Interfaith Center of New York. Since May the 3rd, we've been working with the center on the memorial for us all. The idea that during this great crisis, we would come together at 6 o'clock each week to create a secular moment of remembrance, honoring all those who have passed away. Names have come in from the five boroughs and far beyond, and each week, with artists like Yo-Yo Ma and Kelly O'Hara and Wynton Marsalis, we take the nation's best artists and celebrate those people we have so sadly lost during this pandemic. You know, at a time of such distance in our world, one thing that faith groups and arts organizations share is our capacity to bring people back together. It's especially meaningful that we as an arts organization join you as a group of faith leaders in bringing together people from all communities and backgrounds to recognize those losses we so sadly share right now. This evening, we wanted you to have the chance to see the inspiring very first memorial for us all, which was performed by Jazz at Lincoln Center's very own Winton Marsalis with musicians from New Orleans.
Thank you, Mr. Timms, and thank you to former James Parks Morton Interfaith Award recipient and my friend, Wynton Marsalis, and his fellow musicians for their performance in memoriam of those who lost their lives to COVID-19. Interfaith work among grassroots religious leaders strengthens the civic fabric of New York. That's why we're gathered here tonight, to celebrate ICNY's work, to provide our beloved city and its millions of residents with the tools needed to face hatred, bigotry, and racism in any form. Before I share our next award presenter with you, I want to take a moment to ask that you join tonight's generous sponsors in lending the Interfaith Center your support. If you haven't made a gift yet, please consider one now by clicking on the link below me or head to interfaithcenter.org/donation. Thank you. Your support at any level is meaningful. Now, please join me in welcoming our next speaker, here to present the James Parks Morton Interfaith Award to Anna Deavere Smith, the Reverend Dr. Serene Jones.
Good evening, everyone. It's good to be here, albeit virtually, And I want to begin by thanking the Reverend Dr. Chloe Breyer and the Interfaith Center of New York for the invitation to do this amazing introduction of the James Parks Morton Award winner this year. Union has a long history of partnership with the Interfaith Center of New York, working for justice, not just in New York City, but around the world. I'm kind of overwhelmed by the task of introducing Anna Deavere Smith, who embodies everything that both Union and the Interfaith Center of New York stands for. I first heard Anna, who is, as we all know, an award-winning actor, a playwright, a teacher, a scholar. I can say it myself as a minister, she is a preacher. And she brings us time and again a message that does two things. It forces us to look at ourselves as a nation in all of our ugly past and our complex history. And she gives us at the same time a vision of who we could be. To be introducing her this evening as our country is on fire with the passion for justice and outrage at the murder of George Floyd and the murder of so many others, there couldn't be a more important voice to stand before us and speak to us, giving us both a sense of reality and a passion for a different future. Anna, thank you for your friendship. Thank you for your talent and your vision. And most of all, thank you for your presence to us in this time. With so much gratitude, thank you.
Prejudice, violence, misunderstanding. Part of the mission of the Interfaith Center of New York is to get in the way to fight prejudice, violence, and misunderstanding. Thank you so much, Reverend Chloe Breyer, for inviting me to this event, for offering me the James Parks Morton Award. What a day to be taping my remarks for the acceptance of the award. Earlier this week, George Floyd, a Black man who lived in Minneapolis, was violently killed by a police officer, Derek Chauvin. It was captured on videotape. It was shown around the world. These videos have become, regrettably, almost commonplace in American lives. Protests, riots, looting followed, accompanied by a demand from communities around the country that Derek Chauvin be arrested. The President of the United States tweeted that when the looting starts, the shooting starts. Officer Chauvin was just taken into custody literally maybe an hour before I started speaking here. Activists are now asking for all of the officers who were present to be arrested. Our world is rocked by a pandemic, COVID-19. We're in a moment of global stress. Our values must shift. Legislation, yes. A more humanist economy, yes. Less inequality, yes. But we also need a more vibrant moral imagination. The Very Reverend James Parks Morton created a radical welcome as the Dean of St. John the Divine. Artists, those working for social justice, those working for social change, those in need. Philippe Petit, the aerialist, was welcome on his tightrope. My dog Memphis came to church. It's this spirit of radical welcome that we need so much right now to ignite our moral imagination. I'm truly honored to be welcomed into the legacy of the Very Reverend James Parks Morton. Thank you so much.
Hi, I'm Julie Menin, New York City's Census Director, and I want to take this opportunity to thank the Interfaith Center of New York for its hard work and leadership this past year, catalyzing faith leaders and their respective communities across the five boroughs to complete the 2020 Census and to make sure that New York City receives its fair share of funding for our schools, for food assistance, for healthcare, for hospitals, and so much more. As you can see from the upcoming video created by the U.S. Census, the Interfaith Center and its partners in the Interfaith 2020 Coalition have made great strides in a year that has presented unprecedented challenges for census participation. The work continues. Thank you so much, and let's get counted, New York City.
The 2020 census is important because it's about more than just counting bodies. The census is important because the numbers that are tallied in that census impact every phase of American life.
Faith leaders are trusted voices in the communities, so it's essential that they speak to their congregations and encourage them to be counted in part of this 2020 census. It's essential because we also serve many of those people that benefit from the federal funds that will come from the data collected from the census.
It affects their children's schooling. It affects social service agencies and programs within their community. It affects libraries getting funding. It affects really all of our lives. And if we can't have our trusted sources like our faith communities, like our houses of worship, you know, they have to be the ones preaching this message.
It is time to move our communities forward. It is time to complete the census.
Shape your future.
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 Hello, I'm Henry Goldschmidt, the Director of Programs at the Interfaith Center of New York.
And I'm Hanadi Dola, Program Associate for Community Partnerships. We are so happy to have this opportunity to say thank you for your support and to tell you about some of ICNY's programs that your gifts help make possible. Prior to COVID-19, we had the space to focus on a different public health crisis, specifically the opioid overdose crisis, which is both a public health issue and a crisis of conscience for faith communities throughout the city. That is why we dedicated our 37th Rabbi Marshall Meyer Retreat for Social Justice to build a multi-faith healing movement to fight the opioid crisis. We focused on concrete steps faith leaders can take, as well as hands-on training to administer naloxone. In the retreat, we asked questions like, how can faith communities help? And are we perpetuating institutional racism? One of our keynote panelists, Monique Tula, the executive director from the Harm Reduction Coalition, shared this. People who hold the power slash purse strings and policymakers need to ask questions like this. People in faith communities can use their power to drive this conversation.
Soon after, with religious services canceled due to COVID-19, we asked ourselves, how can we bridge religious divides and strengthen the civic fabric of New York without bringing our neighbors together in person? The answer initially came in the form of a weekly email bulletin, as Reverend Breyer mentioned, in which we offered important resources such as videos to encourage census participation and ways for New Yorkers to support their neighbors in need. Of course, we were not alone in shifting our work online. New York's faith communities responded to the crisis of connection during the pandemic with remarkable creativity, developing new forms of religious life online, while mental health care providers stepped up to care for clients wrestling with grief and trauma by offering teletherapy on an unprecedented scale. We'll explore the strengths and weaknesses of these online forms of care and community on July 22nd. In our fifth annual Social Work and Religious Diversity Conference, Being Together While We're Apart, Building Community and Providing Care in the Pandemic and Beyond. I invite you to join us and the mental health, social service, and spiritual care professionals we serve. Please head to interfaithcenter.org to learn more about this exciting conference. Our longstanding partnerships with mental health care providers have prepared us well for a new partnership with Thrive NYC. With our colleagues at Thrive and NIDIS, New York Disaster Interfaith Services, we've created a toolkit and webinar series to help faith leaders address mental health issues during the COVID pandemic.
In response to the Interfaith Center's weekly emails with tools for faith leaders, we were flooded with reminders of on-the-ground grassroots efforts by the diverse faith communities we serve, who created solutions to serve those affected by COVID-19. We are excited to share some of those with you now. Over the past 3 months, Asian New Yorkers have been harassed and assaulted at a high rate due to concerns of COVID-19. Cambodian, Korean, and Chinese neighbors are afraid to leave their homes, and not just because of the threats of coronavirus, but because they fear being attacked.
Among the images you've just seen were a number from the American Buddhist Confederation, which raised over $90,000 to support COVID relief work in China. Then, as New York became an epicenter of the global pandemic, the president of the American Buddhist Confederation called on his members to help their fellow New Yorkers next and raised $120,000 to purchase medical supplies for New York's first responders and frontline workers.
That is why we are especially excited to present this year's Faith Justice Hero Award to the president of the American Buddhist Confederation, the Venerable Mingyu. Venerable Mingyu, on behalf of the Interfaith Center of New York, thank you for your incredible efforts to mobilize your community. The temples you represent brought supplies to numerous hospitals across the boroughs, and you showed great leadership and collaboration with local civic leaders who stepped in to help as a result of your generosity. Congratulations on being the 2020 recipient of the Interfaith Center of New York's Faith Justice Hero Award.
Thank you to the support of local and overseas Buddhist communities. The American Buddhist Confederation was able to purchase and deliver counter medical supplies and protective gear to first responders and foreign workers in New York. Local civic leaders also joined our mission. Brooklyn Borough President Eric Adams himself came to the Sunday Temple to help deliver medical supplies to local hospitals. Our work to the federal COVID-19 pandemic is ongoing. We believe that only if we work together and help each other, we can overcome coronavirus and have the final victory and fight the pandemic. Thank you for this honor. Thank you very much.
I'm Gale Brewer, Manhattan Borough President, and I wanted to join you tonight to comment on the difference that the Interfaith Center of New York has made for the civic life of New York City over these past two decades. In particular, I would like to commend you for the Interfaith Civic Leadership Program that offers civic engagement training by diverse faith leaders across our beloved city. I participated in a similar leadership program when I was young, and it really shaped my life and political career. ICNY had a tough act to follow after launching this program with a cohort of fellows in 2018. They organized congressional debates, provided pastoral care to asylum seekers, and translated domestic violence prevention training material into Creole. By now, with support from the Robert Sterling Clark Foundation, ICNY has chosen a new course of ICLA Fellows. Here now is a brief video about this great program. Thank you.
Our city faces important challenges from racial segregation and religious bigotry to gentrification and deepening poverty. Too many New Yorkers are struggling to get by in communities growing more fragile and fearful. Throughout the city's diverse neighborhoods, faith leaders from every religious tradition are working to stem these tides of inequality and division, creating positive change for their local communities and the city as a whole.
Thank you to Gale Brewer, Manhattan Borough President, for introducing this second cohort of Interfaith Civic Leadership Academy fellows from all around the city. The work that they do to learn to engage in civic life is very much at the heart of the mission of the Interfaith Center of New York. And this second round of this second cohort has been made possible by the Robert Sterling Clark Foundation. We are so grateful for their support. And also, we want to ask you, those of you who are watching tonight, if you believe that civic training for diverse grassroots religious leaders is important for our city at this moment in time, we ask that you consider making a donation by clicking on the link that is below your video, and also, or go to our website at interfaithcenter.org. Many years ago, we had the very first cohort of Interfaith Civic Leadership Fellows. We had the opportunity to share their graduation with the very Reverend James Parks Morton, who enjoyed all that they were able to do for their community and for the program itself, which he felt was very much in line with his vision for interfaith in New York City when he founded the organization 23 years ago. As many of you know, Jim is no longer with us, and he passed away last January. But his legacy continues in the work of the Interfaith Center of New York. And we have with us tonight three amazing artists who he worked with and loved, and they will be performing for us now. Thank you so much.
Hello, everyone. This is Paul Winter, and I'm here in Northwest Connecticut with my friends Lucky and Nikki, two rescue horses that my daughter brought home. I'm very glad to have the opportunity to take part in this salute to the Interfaith Center and to join you in paying tribute to our great friend and mentor, Jim Morton. I had the privilege of collaborating with Jim for many years, during his time at the cathedral and thereafter, and I very much feel that Jim is still working with us, cheering us on with his wonderful smiling spirit of yes. So at this time of summer solstice, I want to play this honoring song dedicated to Jim, entitled Sun Singer.
Thank you.
Well, my name is Philippe Petit, and you know I'm the man who walked between the clouds, between the Twin Towers, and in a Catskill, I practice on my wire 3 hours a day, and it's a matter of faith to be a wire walker. And when I think about faith, I immediately think of my spiritual father, Dean James Parks Morton, who invited me to discover his cathedral, our cathedral, St. John the Divine. And what struck me about this amazing creator is that he was opening the church to everyone, every religion, every faith, every art. There were concerts and drawings and theater. And I did a few walks for Dean Morton and the cathedral, and he made me an artist in residence. So the Dean is a brother in spirit, and now that he's no longer with us, I salute his vision. He was really an architect for all of us to follow. And I want to end up in doing what a wire walker should do, which is a salute, an homage. So here it is, a au revoir and a hello, brother, to Dean James Parks Morton with the Interfaith Center. We all here, we love you, and we miss you, and you are upstairs.
Hi, I'm Judy Collins, and I am so glad that I could share something about Jim Morton, the Reverend who really was the mainstay at St. John the Divine's for so many years. I met him probably in 1978 or 79. And when I was married, Jim married myself and my husband at the church. It was actually the final wedding that he presided over. And he said, of course, there's a mixed crowd that came to our wedding. There were about 500 of our nearest and dearest. And Jim announced that in order to take communion, you only had to be breathing, which of course won him hearts and minds. When I would go for counseling with him, which I did a number of times, he became a friend over the years. And in his office, which was more like a kind of a chapel of some sort, there were all kinds of Buddhas and pictures of people from the other religions. Sometimes when you go to St. John the Divine's, there would be a rabbi speaking, or Yogananda, or rather not Yogananda, but the Maharishi, or Satchidananda would be speaking. It was amazing. And of course, I think he had a lot to do with starting the animal's blessing, which happened in October, every year still happens. And he carried on the tradition of an incredible, open, amazing community, very mixed, every kind of person you could ever think of, women priests, by the way. And I adored him. He was a generous, loving, kind man, and a great leader and a great soul. And so I want to say that I am privileged to have known Jim Morton as well as I did, and my husband and I are so deeply saddened by his loss. God bless you, Jim.
Hello, I'm Mary Jane Brock, an honorary member of the Board of Directors and a longtime friend of the Interfaith Center of New York. Jim was a special friend and mentor for me personally. We first met in 1982 through the Big Apple Circus, where I was a new board member and he was chaplain to the circus. He dubbed the Big Top at Lincoln Center the Cathedral of Joy and went on to introduce me to the magnificent Cathedral of St. John the Divine, where I have served on the board for more than 20 years. I was the first chair of the board of the Interfaith Center, and I'm proud to be a recent recipient of the James Parks Morton Interfaith Award, and also proud to have been a supporter of this organization for more than two decades. I hope you will join me in making a gift today in honor of Jim and in honor of the center's next decade of service to the faith leaders of New York.
I'm Father Michael Lynch. I'm a member of the Board of Directors of the Interfaith Center of New York. I'm the chair of the fundraising committee. Thanks for joining us this evening. Thanks for celebrating with us. And thanks in particular to the artists who have helped us support and honor the legacy of our founder, the Very Reverend James Parks Morton.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. While we really hope to see you in person next year, we're so happy to know you are online with us tonight. And thank you to all who made a gift. Thank you for your generosity. Good night.
Thank you all for being here. I'm Kusumita Peterson, a member of the board of the Interfaith Center. thank you so much for your support of the very important work of the Interfaith Center of New York.
Hello, I'm Janelle Mayer, Director of Development at the Interfaith Center, here to say thank you. Thank you for being with us tonight, and I hope you'll stand with us as we move forward in our work.
Some fight for love and some for gold.
And won't you take an opportunity now to perhaps help us in honoring his legacy, honoring his vision? We come to the end of our fiscal year. We're asking for your help. Please make a donation as you're able.
Fig and lemon scented earth. Their wine's already Al-Kabir, then now we call Guadalquivir. Is Judith on the road with fresh fruit from the groves, where all prayers are granted under arches, horseshoe and arabesque. She walks along the mountain path where Berber soldiers block the path. They greet Salam Aleikum. She peels an orange just for him. And in his mouth the nectar sings. For now this gift her fortune brings. But gone the old ways that she knows. The mournful call of exile blows. His children on the road. A story. Sunlight, a gazelle, the snow-white frog. Sweetness, feed us in our weakness now.